The key that unlocks Earth's living bounty is water. In many parts of California, there is little or no rainfall during the growing season, so life-giving water must be brought to the soil through irrigation. The San Joaquin Valley is blessed with a bountiful supply in its great rivers that are born in the snowfields of the high Sierra Nevada. Here, during the long winter months, the earth is covered with a deep layer of snow. It's a fairyland of beauty after each new storm. A challenge to those who must keep the highways open. A joy to those who have found here a superb winter playground. To the ranchers in the valley below, this is a bounteous gift of life for their summer crops. In early spring, the warming sun begins its work of melting the great snowfields and ice-choked valleys. The tiny trickle finds its way to a streamlet. Merging channels form a brook, then a creek, and on to a stream. From the higher elevations, it tumbles, pours, and dashes to reach the canyon's floor. In 1926, the Oakdale and South San Joaquin Irrigation Districts built Melones Dam on the Stanislaus River to capture part of this abundant water supply. Each spring, its 112,000 acre-foot reservoir is filled and frequently overflows, spilling great quantities of water back into the river downstream. At the district's Goodwin Diversion Dam, 500 acre-feet of water is stored for channeling into two main canals. When the growing season arrives in the valley and the land needs water, gates are opened at Goodwin Dam and the irrigation season begins. Life-giving water flows into the canals and through a system of laterals that serve over 140,000 acres of land in both districts. The turn of a valve brings water bubbling into orchard and field to supply the essence of life that makes California's farm economy so successful. Ranchers are able to supply more and better food from the rich soil and bring to themselves a higher living standard because of the water systems which they own. But some years have found so much water wasted into the Stanislaus River that disaster came to farms and homes along its banks. You will forget the great Christmas flood of 1955 that destroyed buildings and bridges, fields and orchards in its path. Fortunately, this has seldom happened. A more frequent occurrence has been the drying up of river and reservoir before the summer is past. Rains of economic value seldom occur before late October, but the growing season is still here when the meager supply of stored water is gone. To overcome this deficiency, as well as to anticipate the needs of the future, directors of the Oakdale and South San Joaquin Irrigation Districts conceived a plan to build three storage reservoirs on the Stanislaus River. These three, together with existing Melones, would more than double the storage of previous years and better control the fluctuating river. After many years of work, the Dry Dam project became a reality in May of 1955, when the first contract was awarded for construction of the dams. About 75 miles northeast of Oakdale, on the South Fork of the Stanislaus River, lies Donnell's Flat and the canyon site for Donnell's Dam, highest of the three to be built. In June 1955, road construction was begun down the steep mountainside from the existing highway to the river 1,800 feet below. Within 4 months from beginning the project, trucks and shovels were in the canyon beginning work on removal of debris accumulated during thousands of years. Bedrock lay nearly 200 feet below the river, which meant removal of great quantities of loose material. Meanwhile, facilities were constructed at sites along the contractor's 8-mile access road to permit simultaneous driving of the power tunnel from three headings. The Lily Creek adit was driven nearly 1,000 feet into the mountain to contact the main tunnel line. Seven and two-tenths miles below the dam site, work was begun on Donnell's power plant and the 2,500-foot penstock. By spring of 1956, the excavation at the dam site was 50 feet deep. As excavating proceeded, however, the material had to be brought out by drag line. There was little room for equipment, so the work was slow. A wooden bulkhead was erected to prevent material from falling into the excavation, which by June 1956 had reached 167 feet below stream bed. Logs were used for cribbing at this depth, each one being attached to cables anchored in the rock at both sides of the canyon. Meanwhile, the sand screening plant and aggregate storage bins were finished, and the concrete mixing plant made ready to operate. On July 9, 1956, the first bucket of concrete was poured in the canyon bottom, nearly 200 feet below the old riverbed. At this point, the rock walls of the canyon met. First of more than 32,000 buckets, each holding 6 cubic yards of concrete, which went into the building of the dam. These buckets were carried by train on a shuttle railroad several hundred yards from the mixing plant to the cableway. Tower at the south end permitted placement of concrete wherever desired. During August, the dam had risen nearly to the old river level. This part, called the plug, would become the foundation on which the arched section of the dam would be built. Diameter penstock sections were being installed at the power plant site 7 miles downstream. The power plant substructure was rising rapidly. At the dam site, scalers were cleaning the keyway in the canyon sides against which the arch section would be placed. By the middle of October 1956, the plug section was finished and the first concrete poured for the arch directly above. It was necessary to clear the reservoir area of all timber before water could be stored, Usable timber was salvaged, and the balance stacked for burning. Over 425 acres were cleared in Donnell's reservoir site. By Christmas 1956, the arch section of the dam had risen 50 feet above the riverbed. A month later, the main structure was nearly 100 feet in height. Meanwhile, at the power plant site, steelwork was arriving for the superstructure. The penstock was nearly all in place. The arch section of Donnell's dam had risen 125 feet by February. It was beginning to emerge from the deep shadow that covers the canyon bottom throughout the winter months. Ice accumulated to considerable thickness. The keyway in the right wall shows how much dam still remains to be built above the power tunnel intake, which you can see in lower screen. Steam was provided both at the mixing plant and on the dam to prevent freezing of concrete during the cold winter months. By the middle of February 1957, the power plant building was virtually finished and installation of equipment begun. A single generator here can develop over 54,000 kilowatts of electricity at rated capacity. The dam had risen to a height sufficient to begin storing water. On June 7, 1957, irrigation district directors and other officials assembled to witness the last pour of concrete in this spectacular thin arch dam. 2 years from the time work first began on cutting the road to Donnell's site, the dam was finished and the 3 mile lake filled. The reservoir can store 64,500 acre feet of water to provide irrigation for the thirsty valley below. This monumental project appears tiny in its vast natural setting of rugged mountain beauty, but its value looms large in the lives and the economy of those who will reap its benefits. About 12 miles downstream from Donnell's Dam lies the site of Beardsley Dam, second in the Tri-Dam project. Work was started on this phase also in June of 1955 with boring of a diversion tunnel and removal of rock and overburden from the site. The Pickering Lumber Company Railroad crossed the Stanislaus River in the 700-acre flat, which will be the reservoir area when Beardsley Dam is completed. A gravel screening and washing plant was set up to provide aggregate material for the concrete mixing plant. Was erected a short distance downstream from the dam site, and concrete was carried by ready-mix truck to line the diversion tunnel. A cut-and-cover conduit was constructed to carry water from the tunnel to the power plant. Early in March 1956, the power plant substructure was finished up to the generator floor, and the river was flowing temporarily through the diversion tunnel. By the middle of April, the site had been cleaned and fully prepared for the construction of this earth-filled dam. The steel framework was rising on the power plant structure. All the various types of material required for construction of Beardsley Dam were found within a few miles upstream of the site. Pieces of equipment were needed to handle the materials going into the embankment. Beardsley Dam is 1,200 feet thick at stream bed and consists of alternate sections of rock, pervious sand and gravel, impervious core, pervious sand and gravel, and rock. Impervious core material was excavated from the reservoir area and loaded into moving bottom dump trucks, which never stopped on their round trips to the dam. After the material was placed on the embankment, bulldozers leveled it. Water was added, and pneumatic rollers compacted it. By midsummer, the power plant building was rising and the dam was growing rapidly. Massive steel reinforcing went into the concrete spillway crest, which was now under construction. Down the spillway chute, drills and shovels were cutting into the mountain of rock which had to be removed from this area. Early in 1957, the dam had reached its full height, 320 feet above bedrock. Was nearly finished. Each of these gates is 40 by 30 feet in size. With the dam nearly completed, water soon began backing up in the reservoir area. Testing began in the power plant. Here the water is bypassing the turbine. Water rose rapidly behind Beardsley Dam due to the spring rains in 1957. With the completion of Beardsley Dam, the logging trains can cross the canyon again, and the people of the valley below have another large reservoir of much-needed water on which to draw. The third phase of the Tri-Dam project is Tulloch Dam and Power Plant, located about 16 miles east of Oakdale on the Stanislaus River. Here, near the site of the original Tulloch Diversion Dam, work was begun in December 1955 on the concrete gravity dam that will furnish a reservoir of 68,500 acre-foot capacity. One of the first jobs was to provide access to the north side of the river by means of a bridge. Soon, excavation work for the dam foundation was begun. The head tower track was erected on the south side. This consisted of two pairs of rails, one inclined, on which the heavy head tower could move back and forth. This will permit delivery of material by the high line to any point on the job. The concrete batching plant was erected nearby. By April 1956, the contractor was able to begin foundation excavation on the north bank of the river. This was dug to an average depth of about 20 feet. Material excavated from the area adjacent to the river was used for the upstream copper dam. A stationary tail tower to hold the highline cableway was assembled a short distance back from the north end of the dam. By the middle of July, the full flow of the Stanislaus River was passing through the diversion tunnel. Work began immediately on placing material for the downstream copper dam close to the exit portal of the diversion tunnel. When this was finished, the hole between the two copper dams was pumped dry. Bedrock lay about 35 feet below the level of the river. Workmen began immediately preparing the foundation rock to receive concrete. The area was small and required considerable hand labor. Loose material was removed on skips by a portable crane. First concrete was placed on August 6, 1956, and by fall, parts of the dam had risen to original ground level. The penstocks were set in the lower lift. Shortly after the first of the new year, 1957, the riverbed section of the dam had risen 50 feet above foundation. Outlets for both the powerhouse penstocks and the 72-inch irrigation conduits were evident in the face of the dam. Carpenters assembled forms for the adits to the access gallery, which will go through the dam. The dam is 165 feet thick at its base, 200 feet high, and 1,600 feet long, containing 230,000 cubic yards of concrete. By March 1957, the spillway crest was beginning to take form. Here, seven gates will pass excess water from Tulloch Reservoir. A month later, the power plant had risen to the generator floor. Tulloch was rising rapidly, and as spring approached, it took on all appearances of a dam. Steelwork was placed in the powerhouse superstructure. Trash racks were placed at the penstocks and irrigation conduit. The spillway piers were rising, and the apron nearly all in place. at the irrigation outlet to operate the control valve. Frames for the massive spillway gates were carried by cableway to the site. The erection was a tedious job, since perfect operation depended on their precise placement without damage. By December 1957, the Tulloch project was virtually finished. The lake will provide recreation possibilities for the people nearby, as well as power, which will be sold to the Pacific Gas and Electric Company. But of primary interest to the ranchers in the valley, Tulloch Dam will provide additional water for their fields. And so, another phase in the big job of bringing a more adequate supply of water to the thirsty acres of the Oakdale and South San Joaquin Irrigation District is completed. The land can produce its agricultural crops through all the growing season. The rancher has more grass for his dairy cows, more water for row crops, for peaches, and pasture, for alfalfa. Sheep and grapes, for turkeys and almonds. District men and women are constantly alert to their responsibilities for bringing a more adequate supply of water to the rancher's fields when he needs it. Water that will flow in sufficient quantity throughout the growing season. A big part of this responsibility has now been met through the Great Tri-Dam Project, built without the aid of state or federal funds, and with no levy on those who will use its water. The $52 million cost will be paid entirely through the sale of electricity generated at the three dams. This truly is a monument to the foresightedness and ingenuity of man in making available more of Earth's great abundance.